You are listening to the Montage Film Review Sunday DVD Rental Suggestion Podcast, and I'm your host, Shay Trinity. The first ever episode of the podcast featured Paranoia Agent, created by the late Satoshi Kon, an animation visionary and son of Japan. So shocked was I to hear of his death at that time that I penciled in this showcase of his other works for your enjoyment. If watching them in chronological order, you can clearly see the director's creative progression, which serves only to reiterate the fact that a healthy and thriving plant has sadly been cut down. He was born on the 12th of October 1963 and died in 2010 from cancer. Even during high school, he had an avid interest in animation, so it was no surprise really when he graduated with a degree in graphic design and then quickly went on to make his first short film. In 1997, he directed Perfect Blue. This is his first feature film. It was only when I realized that his script for this movie is a critique of the hunger for fame without substance that I saw its true worth. It is the story of a pop star who makes the transition to movie star by compromising her integrity and agreeing to star in projects which contain graphic sexual content. She feels under pressure to do this from her handlers, as well as the desire she herself harbours to increase her income and earn more money than being in a teeny bopper band ever brought her way. Ironically, once she leaves the band, the duo become much more successful. And to make matters worse, she has a deranged stalker, as if there is any other kind, who considers her to be a traitor for abandoning her music to be an actress. What is most interesting about this animation is that it's a flashback to the beginnings of internet chat rooms, emails, and celebrity domain names that is sure to excite any geek. Kon then directed Millennium Actress, which was released in 2001. In it, two documentary filmmakers take a journey to visit an aged actress in order to interview her about her life. One of the two has a deep admiration for her, which he has been harbouring for many years. The script for this animation is very well written, and you'll be able to see signs in it of the thought processes that would be so impressively displayed throughout Paranoia Agent in 2004. What starts off as a simple interview becomes intertwined with the many different storylines of her portfolio of work and is acted out on screen by all of the characters inhabiting the present timeline. In Tokyo Godfathers, released in 2003, a homeless band of merry men spend Christmas Eve trying to find the parents of a seemingly abandoned baby and, of course, take care of it whilst they look. We learn about their lives and how they ended up on the streets, of course, and this movie is my first experience of seeing homosexuals and transvestites in animation. It is set across a backdrop of organised crime and the seedy underbelly of Tokyo life, and in my opinion is well worth the watch. Paprika, in 2006, follows on from Paranoia Agent, which had been screened on TV in the interim. The plot is that scientists have developed a device called the DC Mini, which allows the user to enter the dreams of others. Those outside the dreamscape watch the dream on TV screens and can communicate with the dreamers by appearing to talk through inanimate objects such as toys and photographs. When the DC Mini is stolen, the doctors and professors working at the operation that researched and made the device have to go on a hunt to find the perpetrator and recover it. This search takes place in the subconscious mostly, as the thief is using the device to enter, consolidate and control the dreams of the other people involved in the project, including those trying to capture him or her. Those people working at the company who were involved in the initial trials are particularly vulnerable. And eventually, a point is reached when a person doesn't have to be asleep for the thief to enter their psyche. Therefore, dreams and reality begin to merge, making the retrieval of the device much more complicated and dangerous. There are lots of cultural references in the film which anyone with any knowledge of Japanese culture of the time will pick up on. For example, there's a subtle reference to the celebrated 1970s TV show Monkey, which became a cult classic in the Western world during the 1980s. I have to say that overall I'm very impressed with the work of Satoshi Kon, and I think that what lies at the heart of his brilliance is the continual use of scripts of a caliber equal to those used as a basis for some of the best live-action films. I find that Satoshi Kon's films become more and more meaningful on the second watch. He pays so much attention to detail that they can only be fully appreciated once the viewer has knowledge of the payoff, so to speak, which he himself referred to as, and I'm paraphrasing here, a little bonus for those who understand. I'm your host, Shay Trinity. As always, this has been an Eskimo Fid production. Come and hang out with me over on Twitter. I am @EskimoFin.